Now, here we discuss about the paper number EL5503, square and pulse generator. Square and pulse generator. The difference between square wave and pulse wave depending on the duty cycle, that we will discuss in this chapter. Thank you. EL5503 signal generator. At present we discuss about the square and pulse generator. Square wave or pulse wave generator. So what is the difference between square wave and pulse wave? It depends upon the duty cycle. Duty cycle is equal to pulse width divided by pulse period. So the main difference is pulse width divided by pulse period. What is square wave? What is pulse wave? So we know that this is your square wave. This is your pulse wave. If we consider this is our T1, this is our T2, then if T1 is equal to T2, then it is known as square wave. This is your T1 is not equal to T2, pulse wave. So duty cycle, if T1 is equal to T2, then duty cycle is equal to pulse width T1 divided by 2T1. This is equal to 1 by 2 in percentage multiplied by 100, that is equal to 50% duty cycle. If the duty cycle is equal to 50%, then the waveform is known as square wave waveform. Now requirements of a pulse. The pulse should have minimum distortion. First requirement, the pulse should have minimum distortion so that any distortion in display is due to the circuit under test. Second, the basic characteristics of the pulse are rise time, overshoot, understood, and ringing seek. Third one, the pulse should have sufficient maximum amplitude if appreciation output power is required by the test circuit. For example, for magnetic current method memory, at the same time, the attenuation range should be adequate, produce small amplitude pulse to prevent overdriving of some of the circuit. Fourth, the range of the frequency control of the pulse repetition rate should meet the needs of the experiment. For example, a repetition frequency 100 MHz is required for testing fast circuit. Other generators have pulse burst feature which allows a train of pulse rather than a continue output. Fifth, some pulse generators can be triggered by an externally applied trigger signal. Sixth, the output impedance of the pulse generator is another important consideration. in a fast pulse system. The generator should be matched to the cable and the cable to the test circuit. A mismatch would cause energy to be reflected back to the generator by the circuit test. And the last, DC coupling of the output circuit is needed when DC bias level is to be maintained. The block diagram of a pulse generator, you can see here the block diagram. This is the block diagram of a pulse generator. This is our frequency control. Through which we can apply the signal, we can apply the voltage to the upper current source and lower current source. That means in upper current source there is a circuit, in this circuit there is a transistor, in this base of the transistor we are applying current through the frequency control knob. Same way here we apply the voltage to the base of the transistor of the lower constant current source circuit. Through this we can get current I1, and this is our reverse current I2. This is our multiplier switch. Through this there is a ramp capacitor is connected. This is our Schmitt trigger through which we change the state. That means once it is connected to the upper constant current source, next cycle it is connected to the lower current source. Lower current source, it is nothing but it is our reverse current. There is a three output. First output 600 ohm resistance connected here. Second one is the 50 ohm output amplifier, and the third one is the trigger output circuit. Through this we can get the output. Now in this structure the frequency range of the instrument is covered in 7 decade steps from 1 hertz to 10 megahertz with a linearly calibrated dial for continuous adjustment on all ranges. That means in pulse generator there is a front side, there is a frequency control knob through which we can select the different value of the frequency. The duty cycle can be varied from 25% to 75%. Two independent outputs are available, a 50 ohm source that supplies pulse with a rise and fall time of 5 nanosecond at 5 volt peak amplitude. This is your 50 ohm output. This supply 5 nanosecond rise and fall time and 5 volt peak amplitude. And there are another source, it is our 600 ohm output. This is the second source of the output through which we can get 70 nanosecond and at 30 volt peak amplitude. The instrument can be operated as a free running generator or it can be synchronized with external signals. The basic generating loop consists of the current source, the ramp capacitor and the Schmitt trigger, and the current switching circuit as shown in the figure. The upper current source supplies a constant current to the capacitor and the capacitor voltage increases linearly. This capacitor voltage increases linearly. When the positive slope of the ramp voltage reaches the upper limit set by the internal circuit component, the Schmitt trigger change its state. When the voltage across this capacitor reaches to the predetermined upper level, this Schmitt trigger change its state. The trigger circuit output becomes negative and the reverse current, the condition of the current switch. The capacitor discharges linearly, controlled by the lower current source. When the negative ramp reaches a predetermined lower level, the Schmitt trigger switch back to its original state. It looks like that. This is our first current I1. This is our reverse current I2. When the upper constant current source I1 reach to the predetermined upper level, at that time voltage across the capacitor EC increases linearly. When it reach to the predetermined upper level, then the output of the capacitor decreases due to the reverse current. Reverse current in between this peak, reverse current decreases linearly. The next cycle again it reach to the predetermined upper level and then given to the minimum. In this way, due to the I1 and I2, we are getting the this type of the voltage across the capacitor. When the negative ramp reach a predetermined lower level, the Schmitt trigger again switch back to its original state. The entire process is then repeated. The ratio I1 upon I2, the ratio I1 upon I2. The ratio I1 upon I2 determines the duty cycle and it is controlled by the symmetry control. The sum of I1 and I2 determines the frequency. The size of the capacitor is selected by the multiplier switch. The unit is powered by an internal supply that provides regulated voltage for all stage of the instrument. So I repeat, this is our original circuit block diagram. Two constant current source, upper constant current source, lower constant current source. In between this, there is a switching circuit so that once upper constant current source connected to the capacitor, the next one is lower constant current source connected to the capacitor. Through this frequency dial control, we supply the voltage to the base of the transistor of the upper constant current source, and as well as we are give the voltage across the base of the transistor of the lower constant current source. This Schmitt trigger change its state when the I1 reach to the predetermined upper level. Hence, when it reach to the predetermined upper level, the upper constant current source disconnected and lower constant current source connected. So due to this reverse current, output of the Schmitt trigger decreases, that we will see like this. Output decreases across the capacitor. There are three outputs. First is 600 ohm output, 50 ohm output and the trigger output. It is given directly to the Schmitt trigger, given to the output. This 50 ohm output amplifier, there is a 5 nanosecond rise and fall time, are 5 nanosecond and 5 volt peak amplitude. This 600 ohm source, it has a 70 nanosecond rise and fall time and 30 volt peak amplitude. The basic generating loop consists of the current source, the ramp capacitor, as well as the Schmitt trigger and the current switching circuit as shown in our figure. That's all.